So a lot of you have asked, what happens after the lockdown is over and we go back to normal? Does the virus strike again? Do we have a second peak? Today we're going to look at this question in more detail. When can we finally expect this to be over and things to go back to normal? A brand new study out of Harvard was just published, and their conclusions are very interesting and provocative. But first, the good news. As you may know, the tides have begun to change. A couple weeks ago, we tried to predict how this pandemic would play out. Now, I was going out on a limb based on the data from Asia, and I honestly didn't know how accurate those predictions were going to be. But I gotta say, I was pretty surprised at how on the dot they turned out. We shot that video on March 17, at a time when new cases were still sharply rising in Europe and the US. We predicted Italy would peak between March 20 and 26. It peaked on March 21, and it's been on a smooth down slope ever since. Spain went on lockdown a few days after Italy, and it peaked a few days after Italy, as predicted. The US, as we know, took longer to act, and the numbers stopped rising around April 4. So the good news is we put the brakes on that rise, that exponential phase. We got a long way to go. We got a lot of work ahead of us, but overall, things are starting to work. So what's next? What happens after these numbers come down more? People have started to talk about going back to normal and opening back up. Is that a good idea? What happens then? That's what this Harvard study looked at. They modeled the progress of COVID-19 over the next several years. They predict that if we just go back to normal after this lockdown, the virus goes back to spreading and we have a peak later on. So they looked at another option, intermittent social distancing. Basically, the idea is we let the infection numbers come down and then we go back to our normal lives. The virus starts spreading again, but we don't let it get too out of hand before it overwhelms the healthcare system. We quarantine again. The wave comes back down and we go out again. And we keep doing this in cycles until we reach herd immunity, meaning that enough people are immune that the virus can't spread anymore. There aren't enough hosts available. And they predict that we'd get to this point around the summer of 2022. All right, I know that sounds really bad. We don't want to spend the next 2 years going in and out of lockdown. The first thing to say is this is a model, so there's a lot of uncertainty around it. It's basically an educated guess. The second thing to say, and maybe even more important, is that this is the worst-case scenario in that model. It's basically if we just sit on our butts and do nothing and just wait for the problem to go away. There are many factors that could make things a lot better. One, if the virus turns out to be seasonal, meaning it's worse in the winter and not that bad in the summer, kind of like the flu, then that improves things because you don't have to lock down as much or maybe even at all during the summer. It's mainly into winter that you've got to implement the measures. Two, if we increase our healthcare capacity, more hospital space, more ICU beds, then we can let those numbers rise longer before it overwhelms the system, which means less lockdown time. Three, if we find treatments that work, like for example, drugs, then the percentage of people that are infected that get really sick and need to be hospitalized and put in the ICU is lower. So again, we can wait longer between lockdowns. Four, containment measures like widespread testing and contact tracing. They can be really effective, and several countries have used them to great success. In the US, this has been really slow. But if it improves in the future and we get to a point where we can test liberally and isolate just the people that are infected or at high risk, then that makes it easier. We don't have to fall back on the lockdowns as much.
We know that we have to do more, and we continue to accelerate in testing.
And five, obviously, if we get a vaccine, then that basically solves our problem. So as you see, there are a lot of outs. There is a lot of ways to improve the situation. And if we get organized, this is doable. Bottom line, the social distancing buys us time. It puts the virus spread on pause. So the key is what we do in the meantime. We've talked about South Korea in previous videos. They never had a full lockdown, but what they did was they acted fast and they tested a lot of people and did contact tracing very effectively and quarantined infected people. The result was they flattened the curve early. They've had about 200 deaths total. The US is averaging 2,000 deaths a day right now. Italy has about the same population size as South Korea, and they have 20,000 deaths total. Now, the idea is not to point fingers and say these countries suck and that country's great. And there are many other differences between countries. The comparison is not quite that simple. But the message is we have models, we have examples where things worked. So we know it's doable if we take the right action. The key is not to panic or go into conspiracy theory mode or denial, oh, this is just the flu. If we use our heads and we base our decisions on reason and data, and if we work together, then yeah, this can be done. So I just wanted to update everybody on the scientific developments and what solutions are being considered out there, what may come our way in the near future, because knowledge is power. So let me know your thoughts on all of this, and I'll let people know if any significant studies come out that may affect people's lives, and I'll see you on the next one. If you thought that video was useful, consider sharing with others who might be interested, and hit that like button and subscribe for more Nutrition Made Simple. Also, feel free to link up with me on my Facebook page and on Twitter for more in-depth nutrition science. 'Cause the things, what, yeah,